All right. Thank you very much. Greetings to you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's indeed a great pleasure to be amongst the Youth Fellowship. Whenever I had time to drop by to Dubai, I always made it a point to be a part of the Youth Fellowship. But while in Kerala, I go to the Yuvajana Circuit. It's always a family feeling to be amongst you guys. And at least in a virtual way, it's wonderful to see many of you today. Thank you so much for the opportunity. A special thanks to Siju Achin, Chiriyan Varghese Achin, Sajesh Achin, and to all of you guys for inviting me. Am I audible enough? Because I understand there's been a net issue from the morning round here. Am I audible enough for you guys? Yeah, I'm good enough, right? Thank you. And thank you so much for that wonderful song, Emil, if I'm not mistaken. May God continue to bless you, man. It's wonderful to listen to such songs again. It just, you know, establish more, keeps us more rooted in the faith to say that you are my God. So thank you so much, Emil. And last July, I mean, at least a month back in July, Sajesh Achin asked me, Acha, we want you as a guest. So I was like, okay, he's going to invite me to Sharjah. I'm getting all excited. And then he's like, yeah. I'm like, okay, Acha, where, Acha? To the Youth Fellowship. I'm like, oh, wow, Youth Fellowship. And then he's like, okay, it's, I'm like, Acha, when, Acha? Friday. Acha, okay, Friday. Oh, which place, Acha? Dubai. I'm like, Acha, seriously? Guest to Dubai? Are you seriously telling me? Are you joking about this? That's my family. How do you expect me to be a guest at my own family? And then I asked him, Acha, what are you guys doing? So I just wanted to get a know-how of it. And he told me, Nibra Chacha was taking a beautiful session on Ephesians, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. And then I asked him, Acha, what is it that you want me to speak? Host, could you please give me the option to share? I'm trying to do that.
Yeah.
Ah, all right, yes, thank you. I asked Achin, Acha, what is it that you want me to speak on? And Achin was like, oh, it's we meditate on different topics. And the topic that he told me was this, anti-fragility in a theocratic and multifaceted world. And I was like, Acha, come again. This topic, the moment I heard this word, I'm like, these are the words I only heard in seminary. And then you asked me to speak on such a topic. And he's like, yeah, what is wrong? You have to speak on such topics. I'm like, Acha, but then this is such a huge topic for me. But then later on, I said, okay, Acha, I'll take it up. I started breaking down the words. And that is when I understood, actually, it might sound fancy, but the meaning is quite simple. What is anti-fragility? Anti-fragility is basically, you know what is fragile, right? We have seen pictures of fragile being stuck onto the cardboard and stuff, where we have a picture of a shattered glass. So fragile means to be broken. So anti-fragility would mean, it has come into being in use for about 30 years or so. It's not an ancient archaic word in English. So anti-fragility is basically not being broken by any external pressure. Theocratic would mean a governance by the people in religious position. So it would mean, when I say theocratic world, it would mean a religious sphere. And multifaceted world would mean the other. See, what Achin was trying to tell was, you are not trying to be broken, whether it's in a church environment, or in the worldly environment that we are in. So that is what Achin basically, I understand that he meant by the term anti-fragility in a theocratic and multifaceted world. I hope, before I start off, I hope that you guys would interact with me along with the session. You are free to unmute your mic as and when that you guys would feel like. I would love to make it a two-way conversation and stuff. Me just speaking. Okay, so before I start off, are you guys all familiar with the three words I use, or was it the first time that you guys were hearing it? You can be honest with me. I think Sajesh Achin's not here, or any of the Achins are here, so you can be with me. I won't be telling anyone, I promise you that. It stays among us.
No, when Achin first gave me the topic, anti-fragility, I believe it was in the book of Philippians when suggestion took this word. That's the first time we heard this word. I'm sure that a lot of us was part of that Bible study. And then I saw that the topic that he had forwarded to me, I was like, oh, okay, this is Sanjay Shachin's topic itself, family fragility. So that was the first word, but the other words were like quite different and wasn't aware about.
Okay, thank you, Levin. So then that is what Achin told me, and I pondered about this topic for about 2 weeks or so. And that is when I thought, okay, I'll break it down to more simpler words. Now, like I was introduced, telling that I am an engineer by my degree, I thought, okay, I'll speak on engineering from now on. And I'm an electronics and communication engineer. So I thought, okay, let's talk about networking for Christ. Now, networking is one word you all are very familiar. I hope, I am sure on it. We are all on networks, be it Insta, be it FB, be it WhatsApp, no TikTok in India, I'm so sorry. But other than that, we are all on the social media sphere. So we all know what is networking. So for a quick Bible reading, may I please ask all of you, please turn your Bibles or please press your Bibles, however you would feel like. By press, I mean, if you're looking into your digital Bibles in your mobiles or something, just press your Bibles to the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 1, verse 35 to 42. Gospel according to St. John, chapter 1, verse 35 to 42. May I request one of you to please read?
The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent the day with him. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard that John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah, and that is the Christ." And he brought him Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John, who will be called Cephas."
All right, thank you very much. He was called Cephas, which is translated Peter. Thank you. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this time that you've given us. As we spend some time pondering on your word, speak to us. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our Lord and Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So it's a very familiar topic, the Gospel of St. John, chapter 1, verse 35 to 42, where the disciples of John the Baptist goes to meet Jesus and they have an encounter, and that's what we see. So based on this topic, I would like to, you know, spend time on the broader topic, anti-fragility in a theocratic and multifaceted world, or in simpler words, at least my way, how do we network for Christ? We are all into networking spheres. We all love networking. But what is our network? So I'll be speaking on 5 points quickly. I understand we have time till 11:20, if I'm not mistaken. Or should I stop on earlier?
No, sir. You can take as much. 11:20, 11:30, no worries.
All right, so yeah, thank you. So when I speak about networking for Christ, 5 points. My first point would be getting booted. Now, we all are very familiar. The moment we start our computers, there is a booting process that happens. It's not that you suddenly click your computers, the Windows screen suddenly comes and you can start using it. No, there's always a time frame for everything. First, the OS gets booted, operating system, and then the operating system loads, and then we have a time for a desktop to all come in. We all are very familiar with it. But when I say getting booted, I would try to say directing to Jesus' network. Now, are we able to direct ourselves to be Jesus' network? Look at the verse 35 in the red pericope. We can find, the next day, John was standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." Now, we look at John the Baptist's ministry. We find that he was one person who was very influential in the life of the Israelites. They loved him. He was looked upon even by the king. So Herod was actually quite eager to listen to him, but was scared because his wife wouldn't allow him. So he was one person who was widely respected. in spite of all that, there were people who asked him, are you the next Messiah? Now, Messiah, like we read over here, which is translated as anointed. Are you the anointed one? John the Baptist always kept telling no. So while he was getting booted, he told even two of his disciples, look, here is the Lamb of God. He refused to be Messiah, and he defined himself in relation to Jesus. So he was always willing to point to the greater one. We all are very familiar with this verse. He should increase while I should decrease. John the Baptist told this verse about Jesus Christ. He should increase while I should decrease. So John the Baptist always directed whomever he had to Jesus' network. He was not at all willing that his name be greater. Now, we live in a time where competing forces define identity today. So I'll give you a very simple example. When I was studying in my 9th standard, I love biology. So my parents were like, Mune, mone nalla biology ekka ishta valle. Sadesh Acha, good morning, by the way. Nice to see you.
Yeah, listen, thank you. And I had to take a class for junior session.
I'm talking on the topic you gave me, anti-fragility in a theocratic and multi. You know, seriously, I'm not joking.
They are fed up with only one word, that's anti-fragility. Because I've been doing that for the past 3-4 months. So please don't speak about anti-fragility, but speak about something else.
Yeah, that's the broader topic. And then you're talking on networking. So I thought, okay, I'll break it down to networking because you would be one person who would be the master of anti-fragile stuff. Well, I'm not a that. So I'll go to my safer zone.
Okay, carry on. Thank you.
So talking about our identity. Now, I loved biology. So my parents would tell me when I was in my 9th, Mone, you have to be a missionary doctor. I'm like, acha, seriously, papa, ma, doctor, me? No. Mone, missionary doctor, don't go for anything else. Be a missionary doctor. I'm like, fine. As I go on to my 10th, I started hating biology. So biology, after social studies, was one of my worst subjects. I hated social. I hope my mother is not listening down here. Okay. She's a social studies teacher. So I hated social.
Yes, I am here. Because he asked me not to come. So I changed.
The answer was YF.
All right. Okay. So I hated social studies. I hated biology. But as I come on to my 11th, there was this time where I had shipped from my schooling in Bahrain to India. So when I go to the school, the principal tells me, we have an option for you. You can join the biomaths class. But I was like, no, I don't want biology. I hate biology. My parents were like, Mone, what if God is giving you an option to be a missionary doctor? So there was a struggle that was there inside me. What is it that I want? What is that is required of me? Am I trying to be someone that I'm not? Am I trying to be someone that the world wants me to be? So we have this competing forces present in the world that we still are. You look at it this way, John, he was under the constant pressure. He was asked, are you the Messiah? But he kept telling, no, I am not the Messiah. He always directed to the Jesus network. He never, gathered people for himself. So we are all very much familiar with this term, I am what I am. You look at Exodus, Moses asks God, who are you? He tells, I am. And then, I am many. We find that in the Gospel according to St. Mark chapter 5. Who are you? I am legion, which means many. I am many. So we usually say this word proverb in English, the jack of all trades and master of none. So who are you? What is your network? So when people look at me, are they actually seeing Jesus' image or God's image? We are all created in the image of God. Are we being able to see God's image? Or are people being able to see God's image in us? So are we being able to direct or get while getting booted? Are we directing ourselves to Jesus' network? As every computer directs itself to the Windows OS or the Apple iOS, where are we getting directed to? Through our life, through our system, are we able to direct ourselves to Jesus' network. So we live in a time where we are in relation to many things. John, over here, we read, he pointed to Jesus and said, he is the Lamb of God. And what do we see there? Verse 37. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. The moment John tells, see, he is the Messiah, the disciples he had, two of them goes behind Jesus. He was at a loss here. He lost over here because he pointed to Jesus. But he was willing to take up that cost. We are, I think, all of you are very familiar with a very famous book. Suggestion would have quoted it many a time by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, The Cost of Discipleship. It's a very beautiful book. It was written in about during the time of Nazism and stuff. And I would encourage all of you to read it. So what we need to understand over here is discipleship has a cost. That's why I put it as discipleship at the rate a cost. There is always a cost. You might have to let go of yourself. People whom you think are there to support you, you shouldn't be relying on them. You should always be willing to point to the greater one. You have to direct others to Jesus' network. So getting booted, let's start. We are starting over here, directing others to Jesus' network. So whenever we network for Christ, as people in this earth, as true Christians in this earth, we have to be able to direct others to Jesus' network. Quickly moving on, my second point would be searching the WW master. Not three W's, not World Wide Web. I'll keep that two W's, WW master. Or else, desiring to know of Jesus. Do we have that thirst to know Jesus? Verse 38, when Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, what are you looking for? They said to him, Rabbi, which translated means teacher, where are you staying? I was very much, fascinated when I read this portion, because John the Baptist tells he is the Lamb of God. But what is the question that these two disciples, one of whom we know is Andrew, asks Jesus? Where are you staying? So there was a desire to know Jesus more intimately. So what we find over here is that Jesus, he was on his way, but he allowed interruptions in his march to turn and meet two of his visitors who had come, two of his intruders, or two of the disciples whom he never saw. This would be at least the first time he is actually seeing Andrew and the other disciple. Earlier, they were disciples of John the Baptist. He wouldn't have had a personal relationship with them. But he allowed interruptions in his march. Why? Because he was willing to let others know who he was. Now, this was the first question, at least if you look at the Gospels, that Jesus was posed to. If you look at the Gospels all throughout, this was at least the first question. What are you looking for? Maybe Jesus is asking the same question to us whenever we pray, whenever we meditate, whenever we do something. What are we looking for? Do we have an answer to it? Are we able to give a proper answer to what we are looking for? Do we have that inner desire to more or know about Jesus? That's only when we can have a proper network for Christ. So what is your desire? When God asks us, what are you looking for? What is your desire? We need to share our dream with Christ. What do we treasure the most? Or what is it that you want to live for? And most importantly, what is it that you want to die for? Now, we all are very sure. We all know what we want to live for. We all have a bindas vocation or an ambition of our life. We want to be this. Now, as I was speaking to one of my senior Achins, one of my friends in Delhi, Deepan Varghese Achin, he shared with me an incident. And he was like, "Acha, I once when he was visiting a church in Bombay, he met a young graduate who was doing his final year studies in engineering from IIT Mumbai. So Achin was engaging in a conversation with him. Achin asked him, okay, what is your dream? And this young person says, Acha, I want to complete engineering. And then, so he's studying at IIT. And then he says, I'll prepare for my MBA studies. Okay, where do you want to? And then I'll get admission at IIM, Bangalore. Oh, lovely. And then I'll get a wonderful job, Acha. Okay, and then I'll go to Singapore. I'll settle there. I'll build my own empire there. Oh, lovely. And then this person is telling. So about 30, I'll go to Singapore, 15, 20 years. I'll build an empire. I'll work. I'll make sure the life of my life and the life of my children are all well set. I'll get married in between. All right. And after 50, what will you do? And this person comes up and says, Acha, then I'll get cancer. So it's like, seriously? And then what, Acha? I'll be in hospital. And Achin gets more curious. Okay, as he was telling me, I could feel the sensation while he was telling me. He's like, and I asked him what else. And he was like, Acha, then I'll get, you know, the first phase will go, second phase will go, I'll reach third phase, and then I'll die. And out of the blue, Achin again asked, and then? And this person like, and then what, Acha? You guys will come and you guys will bury me, nothing else. So the dream, the ambition, or the vocation of a graduate at IIT Bombay is to live a life of to the age of 50, 55, and then get buried, nothing else. What is it that you live for? And what is it that you die for? Today we have a cloud of witnesses whom we actually look up to. We are very familiar with the list of people whom we look up to say their life was indeed a holy one. Why? Because they had a reason why they died. We all might have reasons why we live, but what is it that you want to die for? Is there something in our lives to say that this is the reason what we want to die for? Two of the disciples of John, they come up, they meet Jesus, and then their life gets a new meaning. So we all are in a search today, but are our searches getting misguided? When I say getting misguided search, is our desires for goods and glamour. About 4 years back, one morning when I woke up, I was actually startled by the headlines of the newspaper. It said a person in China sold his kidney to buy the new iPhone. I'm not sure if any of you would have read about it. It was iPhone 8 that was releasing then. And that person, a young boy, a 15-year-old boy, he asked his parents for money. They couldn't afford it. This guy, he goes on, he sells his kidney to buy an iPhone. And in Kerala, in Punjab, very near my place, a young guy, 16-year-old guy, he was very much addicted to PUBG. He used his father was a businessman. He used his father's ATM card and he bought 16 lakh rupees of ammunition. 16 lakh rupees would mean 800,000 dirhams worth of arms and munitions online to play. And I don't know what else can happen to him. This happened last week. And from yesterday, PUBG is banned in India. Poor guy, he lost all his 16 lakh rupees. Now he can't play it. So where is our desire today? We all are living in such, you know, these are two wide examples that I'm giving you. This happened quite nearby my place, and that's why I'm very much familiar to it. So that's where I come to this term, noophilia. I don't know if you're familiar with this term. It is the love for the new and latest. So whenever the Apple announces a launch or a sale every September, most of us are glued to the screens to see the new smartphone. I also watch it, not that I can buy it, but I want to see the new technology that they are actually bringing forward. And the smartwatch or the iPads or the new iPhone that's coming out, maybe the new upgrade on the iTunes, or when Google talks up about a new virtual mapping that's going to happen, I'm much interested in it. So many of us, we all have a desire, but where do our search actually end? Is it just to know? Are we getting too much indulged in other things that we forget to have a desire for Christ? So what are you looking for? What the question was Jesus asked. And the reply or the response that the disciples gave was, where are you staying? They did not ask, are you the Messiah? Or are you the Lamb of God? John the Baptist told them, They did not ask that. They ask him, where are you staying? So when God is asking us, what are you looking for? Where do all of us stand? What are we about? How can we be become you? Are we able to ask such questions to God? Where are you today? God, you're asking me, what am I looking for? Where are you standing today? What are you about? We don't know, we have many images about you, but what are you about? And how can we be with you? Will our lives be enriched? For that, we need to have an openness to say, God, use us so that our lives may be more understandable and more meaningful. So we then experimenting to know the identity of Jesus was what the disciples took up here. We all have information about Jesus. Even these two disciples, but they say, where are you staying? A place is a personal aspect of a person. So when the two disciples asked Jesus, where are you staying? They said, we have some information about you and we would like to personalize it. So are we being able to personalize the information we have? We all sing, you know, you are almighty, you are gracious, you are all loving, you are most merciful. We put a lot of jargons while we pray. But are we able to have that personal connect with Jesus? To say, Jesus is this for me, or God is this for me. So there's this beautiful metaphor that I use to describe God. I would like to say, see God as a diamond. You all are very sure of what a diamond is, no? I hope all of you are very familiar with diamond. Can't you tell them? Suggest that you diamond until I tell you, JMD, I tell you, can't you? Okay, diamond is like a.
Kalyanamai girls, diamonds, good and ready.
അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് അവർ കാണാത്തത് ഓക്കെ ഐ ഹോപ്പ് ദാറ്റ് യു ആൾ ഗെറ്റ് മാരിഡ് ഫാസ്റ്റ് യു കെൻ സീ എ ഡയമണ്ട് എനിവേസ് യു ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ദ ഡയമണ്ട് വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദി മോസ്റ്റ് ബ്യൂട്ടിഫുൾ ആസ്പെക്ട് ഓഫ് എ ഡയമണ്ട് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ടോട്ടൽ ഇന്റേണൽ റിഫ്ലക്ഷൻ ടി ഐ ആർ ആൻഡ് വാട്ട് മേക്സ് ഡയമണ്ട് മോർ മോസ്റ്റ് യുണീക്ക് ഇസ് ദാറ്റ് വിത്ത് എവറി പ്രിസൈസ് കട്ട് ദാറ്റ് എ ഡയമണ്ട് ഹാസ് ഇറ്റ് ഗിവ്സ് അസ് എ ഡിഫറെന്റ് ഷൈൻ And more the cuts, more shining the diamond is. You are very familiar with this, no? So more the cut, more shining the diamond is. So with every angle of the cut you look, you get a different shine. Same way, we all have different informations about God. But when you look through a different angle, are we able to say, okay, God is this in my life? Are we able to say, this is my personal connection with God? This is what God is for me. It might be different from my God understanding, would be different from all of our God understanding. That is what God is for me. That is my personal God. So that is the God that we all need to find in our daily lives. Also, what we need to understand is that the relationship that we have with God is not a reward-oriented relationship. It is not for rewards that we want to find God. But it is for the relationship that we are. Just to say, God, we thank you for being in relationship with us. So that is what I meant to say. We all have information about God, but we would like to personalize. As time is going, I'll quickly move on to my third point. Third point, surfing with the Lord, discovering the Messiah. The response that Jesus gives in verse 39 was, where are you staying? He says, come and see. And they came and saw where he was staying. And they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We find an invitation by Christ. So when we serve with the Lord, there's an invitation, come and see. So when we would like to tell God, I want to have a personal connect with you. God will be inviting us to say, come and see. Or he's welcoming us to share space. Where are you staying? Come and see. You are entitled to share space at my residence. So we find throughout the Bible, there has been many invitations that God is giving to all of us. Come and taste. Psalm 34 verse 8, Psalm 84 verse 2. Come all you weary and find rest. St. Matthew chapter 11 verse 28 to 30. So there's always an invitation when we want to have that connect with God. And these two disciples, they spent time with God. There also happens to be what I would like to call a mystery of silence. They went with him, and we do not know what happened. There was a mystery of silence. And in the silence, there happened to be a bonding. So when Jesus invites us, he's inviting us to have a bond with Jesus. Are we able to be properly bonded with Christ? A physical bond, covalent bond, whatever bonds you like to call it. Are you able to have that bonding with Christ? I think all of you have seen surfing. Surfing is very beautiful. You surf through the waves. But if there are two of you, one person has to hold very, very sharply or very tightly to the person who's at least in the front. It's only when you do that, you both can actually surf properly. Otherwise, your body weight gets misbalanced and there are possibilities that you might fall off. So when I used the terminology surfing with the Lord, what I meant was that at least all of us, when Jesus invites us, even in a time of mystery, in our quiet time, are we being able to be properly bonded with Christ? They spent time, the two disciples over here, they spent time with Christ. How do we spend time that we have today? Usually we always say time is something that we never have. How are we spending the time that we actually have? And for what purposes are we spending that time? Do we have a timetable in our lives? Whenever we spend time, are we finding a new personalized information about God? Or are we finding some archaic things or some things that our actions, our Sunday school teachers, our parents kept telling? This is not for that Jesus has called us. When he's inviting us, he's calling us for a proper bondage to have a personal connect. So the use of time in a mediated culture is indeed very important. So we all need to have a time of fasting and feasting. When I say fasting and feasting, fasting for prayer and feasting with the Word. We all have to fast with God in prayer to say, God, we are spending time with you in prayer. I need to know who you are to me. I don't want to live in yesterday's information today. I want to live in today's information today. And tomorrow I want to live with another information. So are we able to fast in prayer and feast with the Word? The Word of God gives us strength. Every time we read the Word of God, it gives us new insights about Jesus. So are we able to find that new insight of Jesus? So there was a silent encounter between the two disciples and Jesus Christ. He said, come and see. And it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. There was a moment of silence. And in that silent encounter, we find that they discovered, at least Andrew discovered something. He goes and tells his brother, we have found the Messiah. When they spent some time with God, he was the Lamb of God. Yes, all that true. But then they come up and say, he is the anointed one. This is not John the Baptist. He is the anointed one. They had a discovery. So what is it that we have discovered about Christ? What is it that all of us have discovered in a personal way about Christ? So when we serve with Christ, are we able to discover the Messiah? My fourth point for today would be, spread the hot news, declaring the Messiah. Now, an empowering transformation was what we find in Andrew's life. He was at first hesitant to follow Jesus. But when he spends a silent time with God, we find that he becomes an emboldened messenger. He goes to his brother Simon and tells him, he found his brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah. So witnessing is also a task of discipleship. So in the networking, whenever we network for Christ, are we able to, you know, be proper emboldened messengers for Christ? What does witnessing should be a proper task of for discipleship. Now, these are two quotations that I personally love. Robert is an author, he's also a Christian, and this is one of the things that he said. Every Christian is a communicator, a witness. Christians are the media of Jesus. Accordingly, they should be persuaded that before they say a word or post an action, they, as Christ's media, already convey a message. Or else what St. Francis of Assisi said, preach the gospel at all times and when necessary, use words. You're not asked to always preach. You're called to always preach, but it's not necessary that always we have to use words. I hope many of you are very familiar. About a month back at Sihora Ashram, a person called Sadhuji, that's what he was commonly known. Sadhuji passed away. Now he came to Sihora. He spent time there. And there was something very much peculiar about him. He wasn't well versed in theology like Sajesh Achan or I, or any of our Achans. But he was very, he used to go to the villages. He used to help people who were needy. He used to stand with them. For prayer meetings, he wouldn't preach much, but he used to spend time for prayer. And in this form of preaching, he showed to the world what it is to be a true Christian. He did not give messages after messages. The words he used were very, very much limited. But he preached the gospel through his actions. So are we being able to preach through our actions? That is what we are called for. So we are not called here to impose Jesus. Now what does Andrew over here? He just goes and tells him, we have found the Messiah. He extended the invitation that Jesus gave. Jesus told, come and see. Andrew extended Jesus' invitation. He did not impose Jesus. Same way, are we able to extend the invitation that Jesus has given us? Or are we trying to impose Jesus to our friends and whoever is nearby us? We are not called to impose Jesus, because when we impose Jesus, we are imposing our personal information about Jesus. No, personal information is my data. All you need to do is extend the invitation. And that is when the other person can have another personalized, beautiful interpretation of who Jesus is for them. So it's not come and see whom I saw. It is come and see for yourself. You will have a better understanding about Jesus. So what did Andrew do here? They understood Christ, but then they let the other person express it in their own terms. Jesus to Andrew, Andrew to Peter, and then we also find Philip to Nathaniel from verse 43 onward. Jesus to Philip and Philip to Nathaniel. What good can come from a Nazarene was what Nathaniel is. Jesus invited disciples. They further extended the invitation. They did not impose anything. So we find Jesus as a sending Jesus. But the sending Jesus also invites all of us. And finally, I guess I only have under 5 more minutes. Finally, my last point for today would be networking in a new age, deputing by the Messiah. Networking for a new age, deputing by the Messiah. The last verse that we read, he brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas, which is translated Peter. So networking was something which I would feel was Andrew's miracle. Andrew, one of the apostles of Christ, like Philip, isn't someone actually quite big, at least widely described or proclaimed in the Gospels. He was among the 12, but he was not even in the inner circle of Jesus. The inner circle of Jesus consisted of Peter, James, and John. There was no Andrew then. But I would feel networking, maybe Andrew was an engineer, networking was a beautiful aspect or the miracle of Andrew. What did he do? He brought the loved one, we find over here, Simon, Peter, his own brother, he brought to Jesus. He brought the little one. When we read John chapter 6, we find that in the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus asked the disciples, "What do you have?" And then we find Andrew telling, "There's a young boy over here who has 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish." He brought the little one, the little child, to Jesus. And he brought the learned ones. When we read John chapter 12, the Gospel can see in John chapter 12, verse 21 to 22, we find the Greeks wanting to meet Jesus. And they've come to Philip and then to Andrew. And both of them take the Greeks to Jesus. So Greeks were considered to be the learned ones. Loved one, the little one, the learned one. They never told that this is what Jesus is. They did not keep Jesus at death. They did not be an intermediary position to move Jesus away from these people. They kept bringing people to Christ. They networked for Christ. Are we also being able to network for Christ? Now, Simon or Simeon in Greek, at least in Hebrew, would mean shifting sand. What is shifting sand? Now, you all are very familiar with this. Shifting sand is a sand we find in the desert. It keeps shifting. It's not stagnant at a place. One wind blows, it goes. The dunes keep changing. Shifting sand. And Cephas means rock. So from shifting sand, Peter was called firm rock. There was a new identity that Christ gave. So log on to Jesus' network and rock. That's what God is calling us for. Log on to Jesus' network and rock for him. From shifting sand to solid rock, a new name was given to Peter. And this indicated that he gets a new life, a new relationship, a new purpose. Till then, he would be a fisherman. But for now on, he is an apostle of Christ. He had a new relationship with Christ, with God. Till then, his purpose would be to fish. But now, his purpose was to be fishers of humans. So the invitation that Christ gives us always has a consequence. We, at least, can be transformed. So when we network for Christ, are we being able to also say, I am willing to be transformed? So today, I was basically talking about the 5 D's to you guys. I don't know if you guys noticed it. I actually set my message today in 5 D's. We speak about 3D, 4D. I went a step ahead to say 5D. We spoke about direction, directing to Jesus' network. D, desire to know. I have an information. I have a desire to know more about who this Jesus is. A discovery. I have a silent time with God. And that is when I can find new discoveries of who this Jesus is. And then I had a declaration. He is the Messiah. I extend invitation that I have instead of imposing it. And finally, deputation. That is what we find in the life of Simon Peter. You are Simon, you are shifting sand. But no, from now on, you are the rock. Christ deputed Peter to be a better person and bring about change in the lives of men. So when we speak about, you know, anti-fragility in a theocratic and multifaceted world, are we being able to be true networkers for Christ? Because when we do that, our lives becomes the image of God. Do we smell Christ? The sheep has to bear the smell of the shepherd. So if Christ is a shepherd, are we smelling Christ? With less words, are we able to preach Christ more? Thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. I hope and pray that God continues to bless you. May God bless us all. Thank you very much.